Dr. Robert Rosenberg with a sleep medicine specialist. We're talking about the tryptophan, of course, that we attribute to only the turkey, but that's not the only reason we're drowsy after Thanksgiving dinner. Behind us on your screen is the molecular component of tryptophan. This is what it looks like. Explain that to me, doctor.
That's a molecule. Tryptophan is an essential amino acid, which means our body does not produce tryptophan. We can only get tryptophan by ingesting it. So that's one of the important points about tryptophan, is that it is an essential amino acid. You cannot produce it.
Well, do we have to have it?
Yeah, we have to have it. Yeah, because to make serotonin and melatonin, which are very important.
You did say that.
So if you don't have tryptophan, you're not going to make serotonin, which could leave a lot of people with a really bad mood.
but you can get, it sounds like when you overload the body, you get side effects.
Well, if you overload the body, the side effects, years ago, they were selling L-tryptophan in the stores.
Okay.
And they took it off for a while because it was causing something called eosinophilic fasciitis. And it got a bad rap, tryptophan. And it was really impurities in the product itself. So it was off the market for about 8 to 10 years, and now you can go to the store and get L-tryptophan again. It's supposed to help promote sleep and good mood and so on and so forth, but it's really harmless. But you don't have to buy it. Just any protein source of food you eat.
Just have turkey.
Is going to have, yes. Even vegetables.
Yeah. Right. Letting your child choose the time that he goes to bed is probably not a good idea.
No.
And while we're saying child, are we limiting that to a...
Well, under 3 years old or 5 years old, there's a huge study that came out of England with about 11,000 children. And they sampled a control group where the parents controlled bedtime and another group where the parents did not. And children on average slept less than 10 hours at the age of three. And the children, yeah, well, and they followed them for 7 years. And the children who had no strict bedtime from the parents had underdeveloped brains significantly. They had problems with cognitive, they had problems with mood, they had problems with learning. And they found that these problems continued well beyond the age of seven, especially in the girls and somewhat in the boys. And the theory is that we need a lot of sleep at the very young age for the brain to develop properly. It's called neuroplasticity.
Well, why would anybody doubt this? We have heard those studies for as long as we can remember.
Well, there are parents, I have come to me all the time with kids who have insomnia, and the parents believe, you know, I let the child set his or her own bedtime. We have a very permissive society.
Right.
And unfortunately, if you have a very young child and you don't ensure they're getting at least 11 hours of sleep a night,
right,
they're probably going to have difficulty with neurological development. So it's an important thing for parents to be a little more proactive in their child's sleep-wake schedule, because it can have long-term consequences on their brain development.
Coupled with the abundance of technology we have today.
Coupled with the abundance of technology, which also too many kids have iPads, iPods, and video games, even at the age of 4 or 5, that hinder them from going to sleep.
Yes.
And televisions are the worst. The worst thing of all for childhood insomnia, we found, is a television in the bedroom.
Oh, amazing. I mean, I can see a television maybe high school or maybe an older child.
But we have 4 and 5 and 6 year olds with TVs, and they get up in the middle of the night and turn the television on, and their parents don't even know about it.
Yeah, that's an amazing part right there.
Right.
Do parents really believe that child's not going to do that?
Well, when I confront them, not in a confrontational way, but we discuss it in my office, they always go, oh, they're amazed by that. And I find that amazing. But the child will admit it to me, and if the child admits it to me that so easily, have you ever asked your child, are you tired in the morning because you turn on the TV at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning?
Doctor, I don't know if there is an answer to what we're seeing. We're seeing the technology. We're seeing irregular sleep patterns. We're seeing parents allow their children to choose bedtime. We're seeing taking it to an extreme. We're seeing the epidemic of the knockout game situation that's going on.
Yeah.
Obviously, that's not related to sleep,
right.
But
no.
It is related to society gone dopey.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, too permissive.
Yes.
I mean, I'm not a I hate to sound like an old fuddy-duddy, maybe I am, but we've certainly, when it comes to sleep in children, we've certainly become way too permissive. Parents are actually afraid to give their children controls for fear that they're going to hinder their development.
From sleep to...
When it's exactly the opposite.
From sleep to studying for school,
right,
to putting the technology
right
down, parents are very fearful to set parameters for their children. Again, we know that. And again, my inquiring mind goes, why?
And I think the answer is that we've become a very permissive society. And maybe Dr. Benjamin Spock has gone a little wild. You know, I mean, the evolution of Dr. Spock to where we are today, maybe that's part of the problem.
Yes. Doctor, people who walk into your office, mostly obviously a sleep problem.
Sure.
But does it fall into a specific category?
We see people with sleep apnea, we see people with insomnia, we see people who act out their dreams, people who sleepwalk.
Act out their dreams?
Yeah, it's called REM behavior disorder, and that's about 0.5% of the population does that.
Explain that.
There are some people who, when
if
they
I
go
flew
into
in my dream, I'm going to try to fly?
When you go into your dream sleep, we become paralyzed. But there is a segment of the population, many of whom go on to develop Parkinson's disease, but not all, who actually can move during REM sleep. They're not supposed to be able to. And as a result, they may hit their wife, their husband. I had a couple in yesterday where the wife has been struck 3 or 4 times in the last few months until somebody told her to come and see me. They had heard me talk about it. Yeah,
or
get twin beds. And basically, we put the person in the lab and demonstrated that when they went into REM sleep, they had increased muscle movement, which you're not supposed to have. And there are good treatments for it, but that's called REM behavior disorder.
So that's called, when you were saying, acting out your dreams.
Acting out dreams. You
so
should not be able to move.
What's going on in the dream?
Yes, and they're usually violent dreams.
Really?
Yeah, most often people with REM behavior disorder have confrontational, they're
fighting.
Is
there a psychological base to this?
No, there really is not. Most of these people, actually, their personalities during the day are very passive, they're very calm, nice folks who you would never believe would be capable of violent activity in their sleep.
That's where they save it to do it.
Well, they could
no
be.
No, doctor didn't say that.
Didn't say that.
I said
Tanya
that.
Said that.
I said that. Phone number and website's on the screen. Please call or go to the website to find out more information, if you will. Doctor, thank you so
pleasure
much for being
thank you
with us.
Thank you.